The Sydney church in which I grew up was still a rather Irish one. Already by then, my parents and schoolmates, like many Sydney Catholics, were not Irish. They represented a much more culturally diverse Australia that emerged after the Second World War in places like Fairfield. But my parish priest was an Irish Monsignor, Hughie Maguire, who'd set up the parish in 1922 and held office there for 55 years until 1977. One day I asked my parents whether Monsignor Maguire spoke any English. My mother said, "What do you mean, Anthony? What do you think he's speaking at Mass or when he talks to you, when you're his altar boy?" "I thought he only speaks Latin," I said. As a young Aussie boy, I could not understand the heavy Irish brogue in which the Australian church still spoke. The nuns continued my enculturation, mostly by adding a series of myths about the superior spiritual temperament of the Celts. St. Patrick was so important that we named churches and cathedrals after him all round the country. So important that we could break our heroic Lenten penances on his feast day. So important that we were taught Irish songs and stories about snakes and three-leaf clovers. When I attended your twin school of Holy Cross College Ryde, even taller tales of patrician exploits were told, especially about St. Patrick's particular love for rugby league. The best source for the real story of St. Patrick is his own confession. This autobiography, with other historical research, suggests he was English, not Irish, something the Irish have spent 1,600 years trying to disprove. The real Paddy grew up in a Christian family at the edge of the crumbling Roman Empire, knowing and caring little for his faith. But when pirates enslaved him, he came to appreciate the freedom of the children of God and their superior morality. On regaining his liberty, he embraced the vocations of monk, bishop, and apostle to Ireland. St. Patrick travelled ceaselessly up and down the Emerald Isle, preaching the gospel. By AD 461, he had almost single-handedly converted almost the entire nation. The Irish, in due course, were to continue his inspiration by sending missionaries to England, to Europe, to the Americas, and beyond in the centuries to come, eventually even to far away Australia. Here in this cathedral, we have a chapel to the Irish saints in recognition of the role of St. Patrick's sons and daughters in building the church in this land. We don't have thousands of Irish priests and religious anymore in Australia to help families, parishes, and schools pass on the faith. Nowadays, we must rely largely upon lay leaders, staff and students like yourselves, to be the missionaries of our age, which makes you all honorary patricians. St. Patrick would be pleased to know that a college in Fairfield, founded by an order named for him, is ranked amongst the top Catholic schools in Sydney and indeed amongst the top schools in our state. It has, as Cardinal Gilroy hoped, provided an open and welcoming community to people from every culture. A recent newspaper article recounted the story of a young Malteser, Ed Cicluna, who arrived in Australia in 1956 as a 10-pound migrant, started in year six at the college a month later, and ended up ducks of the school. And now I believe his grandson is in year 12. While in many ways our Australian culture still lives on its Christian heritage without knowing it, many people today live from day to day as practical agnostics. They live as if God did not exist or doesn't matter. Though a recent major atheist conference could barely gather a few thousand interested people, Australia is in many ways less religious than the island Patrick set about converting. Powerful elements in our universities, media, and politics are determined to expunge Christianity from the face of the earth, like the guys in our readings today. Even more troubling than the outsiders red hot against the church at present are the insiders who are lukewarm about it. Often they've been inoculated to the faith of their fathers by receiving only small doses of dead faith, like in a vaccination program. When their time comes to pass on the faith, they can't give what they haven't got. Others go searching in all sorts of places for meaning and are left bruised or dissatisfied. Yet as the recent Australian Catholic Youth Festival, attended by nearly 20,000 young people, demonstrated, young people are looking for more and for better and for deeper. This more and better and deeper is exactly what Jesus is talking about in our gospel today. The Jewish authorities argue amongst themselves whether he could be the Messiah, and decide that a small town guy like him, who'd grown up amongst them, couldn't be the one. None was willing to look any deeper. If they had, they'd have learnt the Christmas news that he was the last in the line of David, the one promised by the prophets, identified by wise men, saluted by angels, and cherished by shepherds. They'd have seen the Holy Week signs too. He's being hailed in Jerusalem with hosannas to the king, his dramatic cleansing of the temple, his humble resignation to his fate so that we might be saved. But they were interested in power and privilege, not truth. And so I ask you, young men, why is it you think that these people were unwilling to face the truth? When Jesus told Pilate at his trial that he had come to bear witness to the truth, Pilate responded cynically. Truth? What's that? Lots of people in our culture think or talk like that. Of course, truth, if you've ever looked for it, can indeed be hard to find and hold on to with any certainty, even harder to communicate effectively to others. Some things in life are just complicated. There are many considerations, different points of view. At other times, we're disinclined to do the heavy brain work truthing requires. Our age lacks confidence in its ability to identify and articulate the truth. It encourages a certain laziness in speculative and moral thinking. Indeed, modernity fears those who have too much certainty, that they might be ideologues, fanatics, terrorists. But I think there's more to modernity's flight from truth than old-fashioned timidity or humility. Today, I suspect, it's most often a unwillingness to look too hard at God or our world or ourselves for fear of what we might see. Truth challenges us, interrogates us, cuts us to the quick regarding our unjust institutions or approaches, our long ingrained prejudices or ideologies, our inhumane behaviour or relationships. Truth can demand an intellectual, moral, personal conversion, such as Patrick brought to a whole nation and his sons brought to ours. And so modernity can be very resistant. But my young friends, truth need not be so scary. As the Irish of old and the first students of Patrician Brothers Fairfield found, truth can free, untie, and impassion us to act authentically. It allows our persons and lives to become another gospel, where the world may read the truth. Which is why we need this college to keep turning out not just gifted young men, not just well-educated good citizens, future leaders and professionals, but also future priests and brothers, husbands and fathers, missionaries and saints. As we give thanks for 65 years of Patrician Brothers College Fairfield, helping young men grow to their full potential, we ask Almighty God to make this generation worthy of those who've gone before us and what they have bequeathed to us, worthy of those presently entrusted to our care and what they will do with their many gifts, and worthy of those yet to come and what they could make of our church and our world. May you young men emerge from your school, building on your personal strengths and passions and talents, but building even more on God's grace at work in you, sharing St. Patrick and Bishop Delaney's goals of recognizing and proclaiming the presence of Christ to all people and to all creation. Happy birthday. God bless you all.